In this series, I'll be looking at small computers, games, and software. Although I'm too young to have experienced any of this myself back then, I want to try putting it in the context of this time period. We're starting in the year 1992, and in this video I'm building a computer. Imagine this is my first own computer, one that I can mess with all I want. I want a nice one that won't be obsolete the moment it's powered on. The imagined time and place for the build is around October 1992 in Sweden. My perspective will have a bias towards local sources. For some context, in 1992, Sweden was in the middle of a financial crisis. Consumption had dropped through the floor, and during 1991, unemployment rocketed from less than 2% to over 8%. With that in mind, we're not going for something over the top with this build. So let's get to the component selection. First, I need to decide on a CPU. In the third quarter of 1992, you really had 5 options. At the top end is the 4060DX2, available in 50 and 66 MHz versions. The 66 MHz version had just been released. They were 2 to 3 times more expensive than the next step down, so I'm not going to consider one of those. Next, there's the regular 4060, available mainly in 25 and 33 MHz speed grades, with or without FPU. Some motherboards for the 4060 supported VLB, which allowed for some seriously fast graphics boards. For most applications, the floating point unit wasn't really needed, but you would pay a premium for it. 4060X had a floating point unit, 4060SX did not. Next step down, there's the 386DX. For the 386, DX meant it had a full 32-bit external bus. It did not have an internal FPU. Clock for clock, it's about 30-40% slower than a 486 without FPU, but it's easily half the price. Below that, there's the 386SX. It only has a 16-bit memory bus, but it is a 386 in a lot of ways. About 25% slower than a 386DX clock for clock. One computer magazine referred to it as the people's class computer, albeit horrendously slow, but this time usually 25 or 33 MHz. The real cheap SX ports didn't even have cache. Below that, there's the 286. They were really on the way out, but could still be found at bargain prices. One computing gaming magazine even recommended it as the minimum bar for getting into PC gaming in 1992, insanely enough. Clock for clock, it's about the same as a 386SX, but generally running slower, rarely seen above 16 MHz. You could make an argument both for the 486 and the 386DX. Based on Usenet posts from the time, you could see claims ranging from 46 stomps to 386 in all regards, to basically no difference, and everything in between. Knowing myself, I probably would have cheaped out and gone for the 386. A board with a socketed 486 would have been a better call in hindsight. So with that, I settled on a 386DX, 33 MHz. The motherboard is fairly unremarkable, though a bit dated in design. With 64k of cache, it's still an alright performer, although no reputable store would ever sell a 386 or 486 without cache. Newer boards had a higher level of integration, and were generally smaller, some having a larger cache as well. As for RAM, this motherboard accepts 8-bit, 30-pin SIMs, installing sets of 4. The two sets accepted by the motherboard are 256kb and 1MB per stick, allowing for sets of 1 and 4MB. At the time, 2MB was an absolute minimum, 4MB an ideal minimum, and 8MB preferable, but a bit premium for a home user. With that in mind, I went for a 4MB set plus a used 1MB set. Used 256K sticks were a popular choice for bottom-of-the-barrel budget machines. Next up is the video board. Since I got a 386 with only ISO slots, the choices are mainly unaccelerated video boards, with the main difference being the amount of video RAM. I got a Tseng Labs ET3000, which in 1992 was fairly unremarkable. It's a super VGA board with 512k of video RAM, putting it in the lower end of what you want to get. Soundboard is an interesting one. I went for an Orchid Sound Producer Pro, which is a Soundblaster Pro compatible board that also provides Kovox Speech Thing and Disney Sound Source compatibility. It's essentially a rebranded Aztec Sound Galaxy NX. It cost about as much as the Soundblaster Pro, just a bit more compatible. I don't have the speakers that went with it, however. Since the motherboard only has a keyboard connector in terms of I.O., I also need an I.O. controller. While there are combined boards that do it all, I couldn't get mine to work properly, so I'm using this combined IDE interface and floppy controller. Its most remarkable feature is that it can be set for secondary IDE channel. It wasn't until 1993 that two IDE controllers in one system would be somewhat supported. I also have a generic parallel port game port serial port controller. I've disabled the game port as the sound card already has one. The hard disk I had at hand was a 240MB one. It would have been quite large for the time, costing about twice as much as a motherboard with CPU. I also have a 3.5-inch and a 5.25-inch floppy drive. In 1992, the 5.25-inch floppy format had almost completely lost its relevance, and was increasingly seen as optional, as most software was available on 3.5-inch. It was still useful if you had all the disks, or had friends with all the computers. Finally, I'm putting it in this desktop case, a common form factor at the time. 486 badge on the front probably boosts its perceived performance by at least 10% on its own. As for the operating system, there really were only two mainstream options. MS-DOS 5.0 or Windows 3.1 or OS 2. It was pretty clear at this point that OS 2 was struggling to gain market share, and it wasn't really an option considered by home users. Throughout the second half of the 1980s, OS 2 was seen as the future. That was put into question when Windows 3.0 was released in 1990, and was shattered when Windows 3.1 was released in 1992. So I'll be installing MS-DOS 5.0 and Windows 3.1. Now, let's get to the build. First, I'm installing the 5.25-inch floppy drive. Followed by the 3.5-inch drive already in its plastic brackets. Next, I'm removing the hard disk bracket to make space for the motherboard. Then, I'm installing the 256K sticks into the motherboard. Each stick is put in at an angle and tilted up until it snaps into place. Due to it being inserted from an angle, you can only populate the RAM in one direction, or install RAM will block you. Due to the sets being mismatched, the 1MB sticks had to go in last for the motherboard to recognize them correctly. Now it's time to slide the motherboard into place. The motherboard sits on a bunch of plastic standoffs. The motherboard then slides into place and is secured with a single screw. Sliding the motherboard into place is always a pain, and it took a few attempts. One of the plastic standoffs kept coming loose. With hard disk brackets removed, I'm taking the opportunity to secure the floppy drives from the other side. Next, I put the hard disk bracket back in, with the hard disks already screwed into it. One of the hard disk bracket screws also secures the power supply ground terminal. It's a bit of a pain to get the screw through it, but it's not as bad as getting the motherboard in place. Then it's time to plug the power leads for the motherboard in. Red and red and you're dead, as the mnemonic goes. Plug them in the other way around. Next, the serial port connectors goes in. Time for the first option board, the serial parallel port interface. Followed by the disk controller and its cables. Then comes the video board. And finally the soundboard. And with that, it's time to power it on. Here, you can see me setting up the BIOS, putting in the time and date. There is no auto detection for hard disk parameters in this version, so I had to type it in manually. Followed by the floppy disk types. Nothing interesting in the other two settings pages, although I might try reducing the number of DRAM wait states later. Now it's DOS time. First, I exit out of the installer. The installer would have been able to partition the drive on its own, but I want to use a third of it for something else, so I partition manually and restart. Next, I'm just telling it I'm Swedish and that I don't want the DOS shell. As I partition manually, I also have to tell it to format the drive. It would have done it automatically otherwise. During the format, it looks for bad sectors, some of which it found. After the format, I have to swap disks a few times, and with that, we're into DOS. Now I'm just setting up the sound card in DOS. This is where I could set the RQ, DMA, and IO address for the board. They are fine, so I don't change anything. This board doesn't require any drivers in DOS, just a blaster environment variable. Next, it's time for Windows. I'm doing a custom install. Well, I guess it's Windows 3.1. And again, I'm telling it I'm Swedish. Everything else is fine for now. I'm skipping printers for now, and I don't have any applications to set up. Installing all the options. No opinion on page file. It's using 20 megabytes just for virtual memory. And we're back to swapping disks for a while, 7 in total for Windows 3.1. Next, I'm doing video drivers. Each video resolution and font size requires a different drivers. I keep 640x480, but with 256 colors instead of the 16 you would get with VGA. You can also do 800x600, but at a headache inducing 56Hz. Next is the sound drivers. There's 3 drivers in total to install. And there's sound. How about MIDI? I got MIDI. Now, to run it off, let's just watch a cold boot into Windows. But I think that will do for this video. Check back next week when I'll be playing some games like it's 1992. Until then, thank you for watching.